Okay, hi. So this is an educational video which we're going to tell you about our established protocol on how to trace nerve fibers on corneal confocal microscopy images. Ioannis is going to go through six examples of tricky features we come across or issues with when we trace the nerve fibers.
Thank you, George. So, in the next few slides, I want to talk about what we measure in the CCM images, how we measure it, what are the common problems, and walk you through a few examples that I think are common CCM images that you'll see in practice. So, first of all, what do we measure in these images? On the right side, you see what I would call a typical CCM image, and we have four main parameters. First of all, is corneal nerve fiber density, which is indicated in red. And you can see here, you can see clearly the red axons across the image. And that refers to the total number of nerve fibers in the image. Then we have corneal nerve branch density, which refers to the total number of nerve branches, that is, main nerve branches, in the frame. And what do I mean by main nerve branches? These are branches that come off a main nerve fiber.
Right.
And then is corneal nerve fiber length, which is the sum of the length of all nerve structures in the image, and that is branches and fibers. And finally, the tortuosity coefficient, that is a feature specific for nerve fibers. And to give you an idea, a perfectly straight nerve would equal a tortuosity of zero, and tortuosity goes up as the nerve deviates from a straight line.
So the higher the
So
number, the more tortuous.
exactly, and it goes up to infinity. There is no limit there.
One question about the branch that where you get it, you measure with the green dots. You only do that on the main fibers, the red
Exactly,
lines, yeah?
exactly correct. So we don't measure secondary branches. What I mean by secondary branches, these are branches that are coming off a branch and not a main nerve fiber. Okay, so let's talk about our first image. So this is a common image you will see in patients with diabetes and mild to moderate neuropathy. So what is the problem in this image? It is the crossing nerve fibers over here. So an examiner will commonly identify that as one nerve fiber and a couple of branches.
So yeah, if I can give you an example, for me, that would look like one main fiber because it's very intense. Maybe that I would put it as a branch, like a blue line. Not a branch, but a blue line, like not a main fiber. Is that how you would go ahead?
So I think what I would do there is to actually trace two nerve fibers
All right.
and, of course, their respective nerve branches. And why do I do that? So we count as a nerve fiber whatever runs from top to bottom in the image,
Okay.
and then we'll identify the branches around them. So how do we do this? First of all, I want to say that you start by tracing what you can clearly see. And what I clearly see in this image are these nerve fibers. So when you do that, you can identify your branches as well. So you see here that these fibers, they cross with each other, but we still identify them as two nerve fibers.
Makes sense.
So then I will do my branches, and I will identify the points of junction between the nerve branch and the nerve fiber. Then I will have to decide on what's left in the image. And what's left in the image is this structure over here. And this structure wasn't clear to me in the beginning what it was, whether it was a branch connecting to another fiber or a fiber itself. So now it is very clear that it's running from the top of the image down to the bottom. And I identify this as a fiber, and then I trace the branches around it.
Well, it's very clear to me since you say that it has to be from the top until the bottom. So yeah, that makes sense to be the main fiber and make it a red line, whereas the other ones, kind of not from the top until the bottom, the image, they are blue. That's clear.
Good, great. So then what I want to say, we discussed about fibers that run from the top to the bottom, but you see that we have identified this as a minor fibre as well. Mm-hmm. Why do we do this? So sometimes, because of the image size, a nerve fibre will appear at the edge and incomplete. So we use a very simple rule there, which we call the 50% rule. So what this rule says is that if the nerve fibre exceeds 50% of the height of the image, then we'll classify that as a nerve fibre, which means we will trace it with red colour, which is our NFD and TC option on the software. If not, we'll trace it with the NFL option, the blue color, and we will count it towards nerve fiber length because it is there and we should count it, but we will not define it as something, so, branch or fiber.
So for me to be clear, it starts from here and somewhere up to here is 50%. Anything above that, if it goes from the bottom up to here, that is more than 50%, and you draw it as red.
Exactly, exactly.
If it was like smaller like that, then you would make
exactly.
It blue. Okay.
Usually, it won't be a tough call because the fiber will clearly exceed the 50%, or it will not.
Yeah.
So it will be easy to decide on that, and that's why we have adopted this rule. So then, our next example refers to, again, a common image amongst patients, but this image has got a cell here, which can be tricky. It can be confused with the branch. And what I think is a pressure line over here, and again, for the non-experienced eye, can be confused for a nerve fiber. So let's see what we do in that case. As I said before, we start with what I can clearly see,
yeah.
And that is the nerve fibers in this area of the image. Then I move to the rest of the nerve fibers. Then I will trace my branches and highlight the points of junction.
Okay, I've got a question.
Sure.
I know you may say that this line here is the pressure, but how can you distinguish it from a main fiber because it's also white?
So that's a good question. So a feature we use, which is very important to do exactly this, to distinguish the nerve fiber from everything else, is beading. So nerve fibers exhibit beading, and other structures do not. So you can see here, for example, that the cell here is not beaded, is a uniform white color.
Right.
Similar for this area here, you cannot see any beads, and at the same time, you cannot see any cells or anything. So it's just a very mild change in contrast, which means that this is probably an incomplete touch between the microscope and the eye of the patient, or a very subtle move from the patient themselves. So this is why we say this is a pressure line. So as I said, this is a cell and probably a dendrite, so you have to distinguish between these cells and the nerves. Otherwise, and as we're going to see in the following examples, it can lead to a significant overestimation of the number of nerve fibers or branches in the image. And always keep in mind that you might see pressure lines and you shouldn't be tracing these as nerve fibers. They haven't got any importance for the results. Okay, so moving to the next example. So what this image shows you is a corneal dystrophy, as we call them. This doesn't cause any vision problems, but it is there especially in older patients, long duration of diabetes or severe neuropathies. So the reason I chose this image is because you have loads of cells in this area, and you have some nerves in this area. So what I want to say is that when you come across an image like this, which is not very frequent, but it does happen, you have to keep in your mind that you shouldn't overestimate what you see in there. What I'm trying to say is that trace what you can clearly see. That is your gold standard rule there. So that is the nerve fibers. Then is the nerve branches. You want to ask a question?
Yeah, because initially, I know it's a complicated picture, but then they look very much like a fibers here. Would you not make them blue?
They do. And you're right to say that maybe there is a nerve fiber there. However, tracing one extra or half a fiber is not going to change my results. So, and then you can see that there are lots of dendrites close to each other, which means they might be giving you this impression, while it is not really a nerve fiber. And I prefer to focus on what I can see and be more consistent and more accurate rather than start doing what I call guessing and overestimate the structures in there.
I agree with you, because then this, it's open to interpretation, and mm-hmm. we should go to the things that are more defined, and that will make things consistent, like you say.
Sure. So here again, you can see loads of what we call Langerhans cells and dendrites. And as we said, the take-home message is that do not trace them. Yeah. They shouldn't be confused with nerve fibers. So next example, again, it contains loads of cells and some nerves. However, this time the contrast is ideal, so you can clearly see the nerve fibers and the cells around them. So I start by tracing my nerve fibers, and then, as we discussed before, you can clearly see the beading pattern over here and the cells around it. So there's a very different, there's a very big difference in the contrast in how they look like. So this should be your distinguishing feature between the two. And then I will do my branches. Of course, sometimes it is inevitable that you'll have to trace part of the cell just because they're very close or attached to the nerve fiber. So that will happen, but that's fine as long as you don't trace the structures over here. So then I will do my junctions for the nerve branches. And I think that's the image completed. So then our final example is about a new area we're measuring in the inferior cornea that we call the inferior wall. And we think it can give you important diagnostic information to what you analyze from the central cornea. So what do we do there? First of all, this is what the image looks like.
Like a web.
Exactly. So it is a very complicated structure. This is, keep in mind that this is essentially where all the nerves converge to. So as they enter the cornea, they run inferior, and then this is where they end up to, and they create this this appearance. So
there's only one part of the cornea, and the rest, they kind of have marching orientation.
Vertical, exactly, yeah? Yes, yes. So in this area, we're not going to trace, distinguish nerve fibers and nerve branches, but what we're going to do instead is to measure the length of the nerves. And we're going to come up with what we call the inferior wall length. So this allows us to be more accurate, but at the same time, assess other areas in cases where you have patchy neuropathic loss.
I see.
So that's very important.
So Ioannis, can you give us a summary of all the things you discussed?
Of course, that'd be useful. So I think in conclusion, what we've seen here is some common images, some common CCM images from patients with diabetes and neuropathy. And we've seen what can be sometimes tricky features on these images that can confuse the examiner and lead to over or underestimation. So if I was to summarize in a few points, those features would be the crossing nerve fibers that we've seen. Remember that when a nerve fiber resembles this X shape, should be traced as two nerve fibers and not one.
Yeah.
And then the second one is to define what is a nerve branch. So that's also important to avoid overestimation. Remember, with nerve branch density, we refer to the branches that come off a nerve fiber.
Yeah.
And then is the nerves at the edge of the image. So there you have to make a decision. Is it a nerve fiber? Is it a nerve branch? And you use the 50% rule that we discussed.
Yeah, I remember.
Okay, and then finally is the ultimate decision, what to trace in general as a nerve fiber. And the number one thing you should look at is the uniformity of the structure and whether it runs from top to bottom. This will give you a good idea of what you should do in the particular image.
Okay. So I hope you found this indication video useful, and you know now how to distinguish a fiber from a branch from a cell. Now, if you have any questions, please do contact us. Now email ccmanalytics@manchesterac.ac.uk. And yeah,
I don't have anything else to add. We'll be happy to help you set up CCM image analysis and answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thanks.